Hello. Right there. Hello, fellow pilots. In case there's any confusion about this, I'm John King.
And I'm Martha King. And it is wonderful to see you all here. Thank you for being here. Isn't this fabulous to be able to go to an aviation event again?
Martha and I got vaccinated, and she says, I just heard her tell someone, it feels like we broke out of jail.
And we want to thank AOPA specifically for making this tent available. So many venues have been closed down because of not wanting to do anything indoors, but this is a wonderful way to talk to people and meet and greet and just share the excitement and the fun of being at an air show again, and it's just fabulous.
What a fabulous privilege Marf and I have had to play a role in the lives of pilots. And we're gonna talk about this, but we don't think pilots are normal people.
I don't think they think they're normal either, John. Right. But you know, like many of you, John and I have spent a lifetime in aviation, and we've got just an absolute passion about flying and about pilots and air shows like this and conventions. But probably like some of you, we've always had just a little bit more aircraft than we could really afford. I hear a few out there. When we were teaching our two-day ground schools, we could almost afford, but we did fly, a Cessna 340, and we flew that for 10 years going around to different cities doing our two-day ground schools. But you know, there's an aviation sickness that gets into you after a while. And for some of us, it's a sickness that just absolutely requires that you smell jet fuel. So we got this, and it's a very expensive sickness, by the way. We went out, we lost our heads totally, and we went out and we bought an old Falcon.
Citation.
We get to the old
Straighten
Falcon
up, Martha.
Later. Straighten up and fly right? Is that what you mean? We bought an old Citation, a Citation 500, and people ask us, well, was it a 1, a 2, whatever? And we say, well, we call it a Citation 0 because it was before Cessna even started numbering the airplanes. So it was one of the very first business jets ever built. It was a beautiful step-up airplane because of systems and somewhat similarity and switch configuration, and a great step-up airplane for us. But one of the problems it had was it was not only one of the first business jets ever built, it was about the slowest business jet ever built. I don't know how many people in here remember the old Beechcraft King Air ad that used to say the King Air flies at Learjet speeds. Our Citation was the Learjet they were talking about. They called the airplane a crustacean, a mutation. Controllers called it a frustration. They were always moving us out of the way in order to let a real jet pass us.
Martha and I had this old Citation Zero for about 10 years. You had another one, didn't you? I'm sorry.
Well, I was just going to talk about its bird strike problem.
Tell us about its bird strike problem.
You know, the Citation 500 had a very unusual bird strike problem. And the problem was it got run down from the rear. It was embarrassing. So after flying this for about 14 years, we lost our heads again.
And we went out and bought this old Falcon 10 that we have now and we've had for almost 25 years. And the problem, and this Falcon 10, by the way, was 150 knots faster than that old Citation we had. And so we went out and bought this Falcon 10, and the insurance company was scared to death. They looked at this young, at that time young, mom and pop operation flying this old jet, and they thought, wow, this is scary. They said, look, John, Martha, you got to go out, and in addition to getting type rated in this airplane, we want you to take the full course of the initial type rating in the simulators, 21 days, and we want you to take that. And when we got done, by the way, we sweated bullets, about the hardest thing we ever did in our lives. But when we got done, we figured we must have done okay, because the instructor got us aside. He says, John, Martha, I've got wonderful news for you. And I said, well, that's fantastic. What's that? He says, well, you'll never have to worry about a mid-air collision in this airplane. I said, oh, that's fantastic. Why not? He says, you're so far behind this airplane, you won't even be involved. You know, Martha and I have been flying together now for over 50 years. And a lot of people tell me, you know, you're lucky that Martha will fly with you. And I say, lucky? What are you talking about lucky? She wants to fly half the time. And it costs twice as much. And she's got an opinion about everything.
You know, John likes to think that our relationship exemplifies that old saying that behind every successful man stands a great woman.
It's exactly the way I feel about it, Martha.
What he doesn't realize is the real truthful saying is that in front of every great woman stands some guy without a clue who's blocking her view.
This is what my 50 years has been like, flying with Martha. I want to make it clear right now, in case there's any confusion, I want to make it clear, Martha's only a little bit better pilot than I am. She's way ahead of the airplane, way ahead of me, knows what's about to happen next. And I'm, while she's saying, well, this is about to happen, I'm saying, what the hell just happened? So it's a pleasure to be flying with Martha. Now, as we said earlier, and this is heartfelt, folks, you ain't normal. And the reason I say you ain't normal is... normal people don't put extraordinary effort into things over a persistent long period of time. And you guys do that. You have put extraordinary effort into becoming a pilot, is how you became a pilot, over a long period of time, and put up with a lot of difficulty in the process. Your right leg shakes, you sweat all the way down to your belt and beyond. And flying, learning to fly and flying uses up everything you have. It uses your mental capability. It uses your emotional capability. It uses your physical capability. It uses your endurance and persistence. It's everything you have you use to learn to fly. And the reason I say you're not normal is normal people don't do extraordinary things like this. You're putting an abnormal effort into life. And I have to tell you, it is a tremendous privilege for Martha and I to have played a role in the lives of so many abnormal people. So we salute you. And if you want to have someone hang around good people, an airport is a great place to do it, because there are good people at an airport. There are people who are contributors to our community. All of those things that we talked about, pilots have a passion, they have lots of interest, they're always learning, and all of those things have to do with being successful. That's how you become successful. It's how you make a contribution to everybody in life. So we, Martha, are surrounded here by a bunch of wonderful contributors.
a bunch of motivated, goal-oriented people. And we're going to talk about that goal orientation a little bit later on.
You know, goal orientation is a wonderful thing in most of life. But in aviation, it can be a risk factor. So we'll talk about how your wonderful goal orientation can be a risk factor in aviation.
But the first thing we want to do is we want to talk about how we talk about safety in general aviation. The thing about discussions of safety, honest discussions of safety, is that for us in general aviation, they are particularly important to have with each other because we don't have all of the systems that keep airline pilots safe. Airlines have an incredible safety record. They also fly with two pilots in the crew, with a cockpit voice recorder. They have a dispatcher. They have their own separate maintenance people. And we're doing all of those functions as general aviation pilots. So we need to be honest when we talk about safety. You look like you're about to say something.
Well, yeah, I thought it was my turn. So in general aviation, rather than having managers of risk management, it's all up to the pilot. And I'm going to tell you, I don't think we're doing as good a job at it as we could. And I'm going to ask you a question to illustrate why. I'm going to ask you a question, and I'd like for you to think about this question. And if it's yes for you, what I would like you to do is put your hand up and leave it up and look around the room. And here's the question, and it's a biggie. How many people in here know someone personally who was killed in a general aviation airplane? If it's yes for you, put your hand up, leave it up, and look around. And if you look around the room, you'll find out it's about half of us. Folks, we need to do better. We can and we will do better than that. But one of the steps we need to take to do better is do a better job of talking about safety and get a better vocabulary on the subject.
One of the problems regarding discussions about safety in the industry generally is that the vocabulary and the discussion often is not helpful or insightful, and it can at times actually be counterproductive. One of the problems is whenever there's an accident, an airline accident for instance, I can say this, the FAA or the Department of Transportation is likely to come out and say, safety is our number one priority. Or they may say, there can be no compromise with safety. Well, those words sound great to the general public.
They're very assuring.
They're very comforting.
Makes you feel wonderful.
They assure the general public and often us in general aviation of their firm resolve to do better in regulating and enforcing safety in aviation. But those statements are not true and cannot be true. Because as we know, if we really think about it, the minute that you decide to go somewhere, you're taking a risk. It cannot be zero chance of an accident. Going somewhere confirms that moving the aircraft ranks ahead of safety because it would always be safer to stay put. There is a saying in the marine world, in the boat world, shipping, that a ship is safer in port, but that's not what ships are built for. And the same with an airplane. An airplane is safer in your hangar, but what fun is that? What good does it do for taking anyone anywhere, taking cargo anywhere, taking COVID-19 PPE supplies anywhere? But once we agree that we are going to move an aircraft, we need to recognize that inherent in that, as with any motorized vehicle, your car, for instance, there is a risk and we need to manage that risk.
So these little sayings like safety is our number one priority, there can be no compromise with safety, can't be true. You can't start an engine without compromising safety. So these are intellectual dishonesties. They're really little white lies. And the problem with these intellectual dishonesties is they kind of head you off away from thoughtful talk about it, thoughtful conversations. They don't give you any guidance about what we can do in the future. They're just platitudinous things to say, and they don't help us any. And we think that we ought to watch our vocabulary and do things that help people, because they tend to end the discussion, and they're a substitute for thoughtfulness, and they don't help us any.
A lot of safety advice, sadly, comes across as preachy and smug and superior, and if you only did it the way I did it, you'd be safe. It comes across as demeaning and offensive criticism, and as John says, the major problem with it is it does not give us any guidance. And the vocabulary it uses is not acceptable, because it uses a vocabulary of five hazardous attitudes. And John, I know that you have four of them, but what you don't have is resignation.
I don't give up on anything.
Right.
But telling people they have five hazardous attitudes just says, you got a bad attitude. But how does that constructively help me? It does give you some help, but it's not really a good way to go. It's kind of a demeaning way to go, and I don't think it's as useful as it could be. In fact, a lot of the conversation and a lot of the vocabulary we use in safety doesn't help us. For instance, people tell you that I'm trying to find my spot here.
Right there.
Okay. That you're a failure at aeronautical decision making. Well, how do I fix that? You know, I might be a failure at aeronautical decision making, but it's a demeaning thing to say, and I don't know how to fix it. Or you're a failure at judgment.
You have bad judgment.
Well, that's kind of a demeaning thing to say to someone. It's not very helpful. So if you tell me, I think it's offensive, it's demeaning, but the problem is, how do I fix, what are the steps I take to fix bad judgment? So I don't know how to fix bad judgment, so we'll talk about that, but I do know what we can do that's positive, and that is adapt a vocabulary of risk management. Risk management is the habit of identifying risks and taking steps to mitigate them. Now I know what I can do. If you tell me I have bad judgment, it doesn't give me any guidance. But risk management gives you guidance. So Martha and I are encouraging people to use the vocabulary of risk management rather than this old vocabulary of aeronautical decision-making failure, judgment failure. It just doesn't give me much guidance. So let's talk about the kind of guidance you can get by using a vocabulary centered around risk management.
Because what we believe, safety is an outcome. Safety is the outcome we want, but the way you get there is by using risk management. So, as a pilot, what we think is that you can conduct risk surveillance for your flying by using three acronyms that we like to use, three mnemonics, PAVE, CORD, and CARE, and we're gonna talk about each one of them here. And the first one is PAVE, and PAVE is a pre-flight planning mnemonic to pave your way to a safe flight. The P stands for the pilot, the A for the aircraft, the V for environment, the environment you're operating in, and the E for external and internal pressures.
So what we're saying is you're getting ready to go on a trip, and you think first of all about the risks associated with the pilot. And the the obvious thing is, am I the right pilot for this trip? We're going to fly an IFR, am I instrument rated? We're going to fly a twin-engine airplane, am I multi-engine rated? We're going to fly at nighttime, am I current at night? Am I the right person to do this trip? And it doesn't mean you can't go. It just means you might go at a different time, a different route, a different airplane. So what you want to do is make sure that you have matched the pilot, which would be you, with that trip. And so we want to start off thinking about the pilot. And also, how you feeling? You want to use what the FAA uses, the I'm safe mnemonic. Do you have an illness? You have a bad cold? Are you feeling lousy? Did you just get your COVID number two shot? This is not the day for you to go then. Are you taking any medication, like cold medication, makes you drowsy? Are you under stress? Are you really having a hard time? Are you going to be a good decision maker? Are you going to be a good physical controller of the aircraft? Alcohol, of course, is a problem. Fatigue and food. A lot of people will work all day and then decide to go off on a trip in the evening. They're fatigued and they haven't eaten anything, and they take off and they're going to fly the airplane. It's probably not in their best shape right now to fly the airplane. And finally, emotion. If you're mad at the world, it's not the best time. The way to work it out is not go fly an airplane. So you think about, I'm safe for the pilot. Am I the right pilot? So you're thinking about the risks associated with the pilot, and you figure out, well, how can I mitigate those risks?
We're not talking about a no-go decision here. What we're talking about is, how do we mitigate risks that we identify? And we're using PAVE just simply to put those identified, put risks into identified categories, so we can organize our thoughts and think about them a little bit better.
Now, the A stands for the aircraft. And what you want to think about, how does this aircraft match up with this trip? If I'm going to go at night, well, is the aircraft equipped for night? Does it have lights? Can you see the panel? Are there exterior lights? And if it's not equipped for night, either get it equipped or go at a different time. If you're going to fly a high altitude, is it an aircraft that's capable of high altitude? Well, if it's not capable of high altitude, go around the mountains. Just some way to mitigate it, but you want to think about, is this the right aircraft? Am I utilizing the aircraft in the right way? So that's what the A is.
Does it have the range for the trip? Is it just barely enough range? Maybe you should, instead of just barely getting there, plan a fuel stop, which may require a slight change in your routing. But mitigating the issues that the aircraft presents may let you go when otherwise you might look at it and say, I don't think so. The V in PAVE stands for the environment that you're operating in. Daytime, nighttime, are you going to be out over the desert at night? If so, it's like an IFR flight. You need to be aware of that. Are you going to be operating in busy Class Bravo airspace? Are your communication and piloting skills up to that? Are you going to be going over a big stretch of water or over the mountains? What environment are you going to be operating in? And the E stands for the external and internal pressures. And this is where the goal orientation that John mentioned at the beginning comes in, because we pilots are very goal-oriented people. We really hate to give up on a goal once we've set it, and particularly once we've started out on a trip. And what you don't want to do is let the external and internal pressures make you ignore risks. Those pressures are things like, why are you going? Are you going to a family wedding? Are you going to an important business meeting? Are you going to a high school reunion to see friends you haven't seen for years? A vacation that you've prepaid for? We suggest that you think about those pressures ahead of time and recognize that they are going to push you to do things that you maybe shouldn't do. So how do you mitigate that? Do you need to go a day early before an important business meeting? Do you need to have backup plans in case the weather doesn't work out properly? Just don't let those pressures make you ignore the risks that you see elsewhere in your flight.
You know, oftentimes you'll look at a pilot who makes a lousy decision and they wind up killing themselves and several people on board the aircraft, and you think to yourself, what in the world was this pilot thinking? Well, I can tell you what they were thinking. They were thinking they didn't want to give up on a goal. They kept on going in lousy weather. They ran themselves out of fuel because they just didn't want to give up on a goal. So the biggest risk factor in all of aviation is right between our own two ears, is that we set out to do something, we're going to meet somebody at the airport, or we set a fuel stop. We had a couple come to us one time after a talk and said, you know, here's something you need to tell people. Tell them if they pick a fuel stop, in the dead center of the trip, not at the far end. Because if you pick a fuel stop at the far end, you'll, how many people in here know, ask your fuel gauge question.
Oh, okay. How many people in here believe that general aviation fuel gauges are absolutely reliable and acceptable? Okay, John, I've got no takers.
I didn't see a big show of hands. But so the problem in general aviation is you look at those fuel gauges, well, that never did work right anyway. And so you keep on going, and you run yourself out of gas. And what this couple was saying to us, if you pick a stop in the middle of the trip, you're going to remove yourself from that risk. The nuns, when I was in grade school, used to say, don't put yourself in the occasion of sin. In other words, don't set yourself up for trouble. And that's what pilots have a tendency to do if they keep on going. So what you want to do is head off the external and internal pressures that make you continue going when you should stop. And we, Martha and I, if we're going to go out flying for just an afternoon, we'll put a suitcase in the aircraft. And so if we have a problem with the aircraft or with the weather, we'll say, hey, let's just spend the night in a hotel, have a nice dinner. We'll worry about this tomorrow morning. And so we try and remove ourselves from the occasion of sin. We try and remove ourselves from making those decisions. So what you want to do as a pilot, I think a good idea is to always think ahead. How you manage these internal and external pressures is you think ahead. If I promise someone to meet me, why don't I tell them I'll call them when I get in instead of meeting me at the airport? So what you want to do is think ahead. How can I take myself out of the situation where I set myself up to continue when I shouldn't? So you can manage those internal and external pressures, and that's what we need to do as pilots. Go ahead, Martha.
So PAVE lets you think about the potential risks on a flight and figure out how to mitigate them before you ever take off. But before takeoff, just before takeoff, you can strike the right chord, that's our next mnemonic, to manage the risks of takeoff. And chord, and we're going to go through these, stands for the conditions that day, the hazards, any operational changes, the runway required and available, the return, and the departure.
So Martha and I came up with this chord in order to, we're flying an airplane that requires two pilots, and we're supposed to be able to get along with each other in the airplane.
That's what they say, John.
And so what we do, when we taxi the airplane, we're approaching the runway, we do the chord checklist, and it's our briefing of what's going on right now just before takeoff. We say, okay, what are the conditions? Well, it's a little windy, and we'll have a right crosswind on takeoff, and we'll, that's the hazard operationally, what we're going to do. The hazards are a slick runway. It's going to be a slick runway. The O stands for what operationally are we going to do to mitigate the hazard? How are we going to deal with it? So we do the conditions, the hazards associated with those conditions, and the operational changes we're going to do. Then the R, please excuse me, the R stands for the runway required and the runway available. You get the runway required off of your checklist, and or you calculate the runway required for your takeoff, and then the runway available, of course, you get off the airport diagram. So you match those up, how much runway left do we have? And then R is how are we going to return? And in a jet, the way you're probably going to return is you're going to do, if it's IFR, you're going to get an IFR approach to this airport. If it's not IFR, you're going to go this way, and this way, and come back and land at the runway. So, but what we do is we discuss how are we going to return while we're taxiing down the runway. And finally, the last one is how are we going to depart? And if you're flying an IFR airplane, you're flying IFR, you're going to follow the clearance. So we'll repeat the clearance at that time. If it's not an IFR aircraft, it's not an IFR trip, we'll say, well, we're going to go to the coast, we're going to turn right, and then we're going to go back to the east. And so we'll work out our plan, so we'll have that all figured out. So when we complete this core checklist, we've briefed the takeoff. Now, if you're in a VFR airplane, the return is if you've had an engine failure. In a VFR aircraft, and you really start briefing this when you're in a hangar before you go. And what you do is you get a picture of the aircraft and look at the area around it. I meant airport. Picture of the airport, look at the area around it. You say, well, here's an open spot we can aim for. It's about 30 degrees off to the right. That'll work. So we'll go there. We have a road we call Balboa International. You're going to land on Balboa Highway. And so you figure out how you're going to get there, what route you're going to get there, and you brief that and have that done. So you remind yourself of that briefing for a VFR airplane, if you're a single engine airplane, that if the engine quits, here's what we're going to do. And there's always people talking about the impossible turn. Well, in some cases, you can make it back, but you want to have been trained in that. At what altitude is it possible? And you're talking about how high above the ground, and look on this particular trip, it'll be an altimeter number above the airport. So you say, what will the altitude say? What's the lowest altitude on the altimeter in which I can make it back? And so you say, well, we can do it at, say, 1,300 feet MSL. So you say, okay, above 1,300 feet MSL, we have an option of going back. So you brief this with yourself or with other people, and here's the pitch attitude I would use, here's the bank angle I would use, and here's how I would get back. And if you're going to do it, you probably ought to have tried it before, because it's not all that easy. And if you're going, but there is an altitude above which it's doable and reasonably safe. So what you want to do is brief these through before you take off. So that's what we do with the cord briefing. It's just a briefing before takeoff. If it's a two-pilot operation, you go over it with each other. If you're by yourself, you just go through that and refresh your mind on what you're going to do as you put the throttle forward and go, and the options of whether we're going to continue or whether we're going to return and how we're going to do it and under what circumstances. And that's the cord checklist.
So now you've taken off and you're airborne and you're en route. We use the mnemonic SeaCare, take care to manage risk while you're en route. And SeaCare stands for changes, and then consequences, alternatives, reality, and again, the external and internal pressures. Basically, at this point, you're doing a risk management attention scan with the control of the aircraft always primary, but spoking out, if you will, to look at the changes that are happening on your flight. What are the consequences of those? What alternatives do you have left? What new alternatives do you need to make? What is your current reality? And under these new circumstances, what external pressures, if any, are pushing on you? With consequences, you know, the minute you get airborne, everything starts changing, because the whole point of an airplane is moving across country and over time. So all of those components on the PAVE checklist start changing. The pilot gets more tired, the aircraft gets lower on fuel, possibly develops a mechanical issue. The environment is changing. You may now be over the mountains when previously you were over flat country. And the external pressures on you change as you get further along in the flight.
So the C stands for consequences. When you think of the consequences, what you want to think about, all right, what's changed? And what are the consequences of that? And when you think about the consequences, you would want to think through several layers, with several levels. For instance, let's assume you take off and you get airborne and you look over at your GPS and you say, son of a gun, look at that. We're about 20 knots slower than we thought we were going to be. All right, let's think about the consequences. First of all, if you're 20 knots slower than you thought you were going to be, what's likely the cause of that? Well, the wind is different than you thought it was going to be. So therefore, your ground speed is slower, and the wind determines the locations of pressure patterns and fronts. So therefore, if the wind is different than you thought it was going to be, it's likely the weather is going to be different than you thought it was going to be. So now let's think all through all of this. First of all, if you're going to be slower, you're going to arrive at your destination later, under time pressure, feeling like you need to hurry, you're late. You're gonna arrive more fatigued. You're gonna arrive lower on fuel. And because of the fact that your ground speed is determined by the wind and the wind is different, the weather is going to probably be different than you thought it was going to be and likely worse. So these are all the consequences of that slower ground speed. Now, the A in CARE, C-CARE, stands for alternatives. And the most important consideration in all of aviation is to always have an alternative. Always know what you're going to do if things don't work out the way you planned them to be. That's the whole idea of aviation, having alternatives. So what you now have is different alternatives. So this all happened simply because you looked up there and you looked at your ground speed and it was slower than you thought it was going to be. So now when you took off, you had a big circle of alternatives equal to the length of your trip and plus your reserves in fuel in all directions. But as you fly along, your circle of alternatives gets smaller and smaller and smaller. And so by the time you land at the airport, your alternative times is only equal to the amount of reserve fuel you have in all directions. So when you find that your alternatives change due to being slower on ground speed, it becomes a no-brainer to simply land and re-expand your circle of alternatives to that great big circle of alternatives you had when you took off. And that becomes an easy decision when you think about it that way. So you want to think about your alternatives. And then finally, the R, well, next the R, stands for reality.
And reality simply means, as pilots, we have to deal with things as they really are, not the way we plan them to be. We put a lot of effort into good flight planning. And most of the time it works out okay, but it not always. And when it doesn't work out properly, we have to deal with that because that is the new reality that we have. Does anyone in here remember what the biggest cause of cross-country fatalities is? The biggest cause of cross-country fatalities is continued VFR into worsening weather. Now, do you think that anybody takes off deliberately into weather that they know will kill them? Of course not. They take off because the forecast said it would be okay, or the forecast said it would be marginal, but you'll probably be okay. And things got worse than they expected. And what happened? They just kept right on going as if nothing had changed. Reality means that when things change, you do have to change your plan.
So let me ask you a question. Why do pilots continue going in conditions that they know will kill them? Because they deny reality. Why do they deny reality? Because it interferes with their plans. They want to keep on going. It's in between these two ears that the pilot says, I want to keep going. Well, the a lot of times the pressure that makes you deny reality is in your ears, in between your ears. It's you It's goal orientation. You hate to give up on a goal. And we said earlier, goal orientation is wonderful in almost all of life. But in aviation and as a pilot, it's a risk factor. So what you need to do to think about this goal orientation is understand before you go and as you go, remind yourself of what would make you continue going when you really shouldn't continue going. What pressures are pushing you to go on when you really shouldn't? And so that takes care of the reality and that takes care of external pressures.
So what we have to do as general aviation pilots is come to terms with the tension that John is talking about between our goal orientation and the reality of our circumstances. We do not want or need to be as rigid as the airlines are, but we do have to accept reasonable limitations on our utility. I mean, after all, the airlines cancel flights when the snow gets too strong or they've got freezing rain or there's a hurricane moving through or whatever it is. And we need to realize that because of the much lesser capability of our airplanes, we're going to have to cancel more often than the airlines do for conditions that are not bad enough for them to have to cancel. But we have to accept reasonable limitations.
You know, we had the show of hands earlier of people that we knew that who got killed in general aviation aircraft. And what we said is, that means we're not doing as good a job as we could do. And the reason for that is we have the option of not doing as good a job. If you're a crew on an airliner, a lot of these things are predetermined. You don't have the option of keep on going or landing in an airport below minimums because the company just won't let you do it. You wouldn't have a career afterwards if you do that. But in general aviation, we can get away with it. We have more flexibility and more room. So what we need to do is change those things and manage those pressures on ourselves. One of the reasons that we continue on aviation when we shouldn't is what I call the big lie. And a big lie is one you've been telling so long and so frequently that you believe it yourself. And the big lie in general aviation has been the most dangerous part of the trip was the drive to the airport. That's horse feathers. That is not correct. You are 5 times more likely to be involved in a fatality in general aviation per mile than you are in a car. The flight part in a general aviation airplane is by far the most dangerous part. But if we deny it, we're trying to keep on going and we don't want to change anything. We cannot afford to deny that anymore. We need to accept that reality. And we know that we need to change things and we need to manage the risks in aviation.
So what we hope that you'll do is use the mnemonics, PAVE, CORD, and SEA CARE, to manage the in-flight risks when you fly, and that way we'll be able to see you all next year when we're here.
Yeah, you know, Martha and I have been kicked out of a lot of nice places. So to avoid that, I'd like to make a special risk for you, or a wish for you. Did I say risk? Wish, I say risk so much. Special wish for you, and that is keep the pointy end forward, the dirty side down. And by all means, please.
Stay out of the trees.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for being here.